Some cities across the world are sinking. These pictures give you an idea of what's happening. There are both natural and human reasons for this. Climate change, too much groundwater being pumped out, and the land cities are built on can all affect things. Research shows 90% of megacities, places like Karachi and New York, are all vulnerable. This episode isn't about the doom and gloom, though. We wanted to get an idea of the solutions people and governments are coming up with to protect their cities. I'm Ikra Farouk, and this is What's in the World from the BBC World Service. And I'm here with Aghnia Adzkia, who is a BBC journalist in Jakarta, Indonesia. Hey, Aghnia.
Hi, Ikra. How are you?
I'm not too bad. How are you doing?
I'm good, thank you.
Okay, so you're in Jakarta, one of the fastest sinking cities in the world. Why is that the case?
So there are factors, natural factor and also man-made factor that makes a city sinking. So when we talk about natural factor, Jakarta is a coastal city that lies on low-lying delta, which rivers divide before flowing into the sea, meaning that Jakarta's soil is more compressible than others and also prone to compaction. And the second factor is man-made, which is extraction of groundwater pumping. So it's not about small amount, but excessive extraction of groundwater that makes the city sink.
And I'm just pulling up a definition here, Aghnia, because when we talk about groundwater, we mean the water that is found in rocks under the ground. So on top of the groundwater, there is soil. And on top of the soil, we have buildings. So when the water is pumped out, the soil surface sinks and the ground we walk on also sinks. So it sounds a bit scary. How fast is that sinking happening?
Yes, that's correct. So in Jakarta itself, the highest sinking rate, the researchers found it in northern part of Jakarta. So it has sunk by 11 centimeters per year from 2014 to 2020. And that's, they say it's high. But if we compare to other parts of Jakarta, it sinks slower than the northern part, range from like 1 centimeter to 11 centimeters. So depending on each of the location of the area.
And so is climate change also playing a role here?
Yes, of course. When we talk about sinking cities, it has two components. The first one is land is sinking, and the second one is sea is rising. And this sea is rising part is mainly driven by climate change.
So let's hear a bit more about the link between climate change and sea level rise. Here is our BBC climate reporter, Georgina Rannard.
Our planet's changing climate is leading to sea level rise in two main ways. The first one you've probably heard of, and that is melting glaciers and melting ice. Warmer temperatures around the globe are causing Antarctica's vast icebergs to melt. All of that water that used to be locked up, frozen, is entering our oceans, and that is pushing up sea levels. The other main reason is something called thermal expansion. The oceans are absorbing a lot of that heat, and as it does that, the water expands. That means it's taking up more space in the oceans, and that is also driving up sea levels. And scientists say that the global average sea level has risen 8 to 9 inches, or 21 to 24 centimeters, since 1880. And by the end of this century, they're expected to rise a foot, that's 0.3 meters, and it could even be more.
So more than 10 million people live in Jakarta, huge population. How are they being affected by the sinking then?
So I went to northern part of Jakarta area and spoke to a couple of people living there. So their houses are sinking from time to time. And I remember like last year when I visited there, so they needed to build the house floor to up to like 30 centimeters to avoid floods in the coming years. And they needed to do that gradually. I'm talking about not like in 1 year, but in 10 years. So in one house that I went there, they needed to elevate the floor up to 1 meter. It's not only one house, but lots of like houses in one area in northern part of Jakarta. So that is real, and we can see from our eyes that the houses is sinking. And also in some parts of the area as well, I found a couple of buildings leaning toward one side because of the uneven surface that caused by the sinking of the land.
You really get an idea how this is changing people's lives. And we know it's not just Jakarta dealing with this, with the sinking. I know you've been speaking to some researchers behind a 2020 study looking at other cities that are sinking, right?
Yes, correct.
Just tell us a little bit more about what's in that study.
So the scientists look at 48 cities across the globe, and they found these coastal cities are sinking at worrying speed. So there are variation like from 1 centimeter to 11 centimeters in Jakarta or to 18 centimeters in Tianjin in China. And that is very worrying because the effect of the sinking and also combined with climate change, it can bring more severe and also prolonged floods if the government or communities don't act or mitigate the sinking.
We know groundwater being pumped out is one of the key reasons for Jakarta's sinking. But what about other cities? When it comes to them, what are the other reasons some cities are sinking around the world?
They are varied, but I spoke to lots of scientists and they said mainly it's driven by groundwater. So the sinking is not happening in just like last 2 years or last year. It happened as a result of the activities done like decades ago, 30 years ago or 40 years ago. And people didn't acknowledge that groundwater pumping as the cause of the sinking and they didn't know. But as the time past, they started to learn about it and then started to look at how other cities solve those problems as well. So groundwater, yes, is the primary cause and also natural factors like Jakarta soil, as I mentioned earlier, also other cities like in Manila and Hong Kong, they've got as well like this more compressible soil that can cause the groundwater that can cause the sinking happening faster than other areas. And also land reclamation when the government or industries put more land on the edge of the oceans to build infrastructures, that also can cause the cities to sink.
And it seems like a lot of the worst affected cities are in Asia. Why is that? Is there a reason for that?
Yes, urbanization, because people move to those big cities for work, for better life, and then they need more water for like drinking, for cleaning the houses, for any other daily activities. But in those cities, government doesn't provide pipe water enough to those people. So when they didn't find it, they tend to like drill wells and taking out of the groundwater by themselves. We can see in those ASEAN cities, people have wells on the front of the houses, back of the houses, or even inside the house, but underneath. So they kind of like put floors just beneath the pumping or the well.
All right. Well, I said at the start of the episode that it can all be doom and gloom and we don't want to focus on that. So what are the Indonesian government saying about all this? Are they introducing any measures to help?
So the good thing is Indonesian government started to recognize groundwater as the cause of the sinking because I've spoken to scientists and some of the cities, some of the government in those African cities, for example, they don't recognize groundwater as the cause of the sinking. So it's good that the government has recognized it first and then they started to ban groundwater pumping in some areas. And one of the alternatives they've provided is moving the capital to another island. But then another question would be how they would provide the water to those people in the new capital city. And also another controversy came up that experts thought the environment impact of those capital moving is also big, especially on those area where biodiversity is very rich and we can see lots of like plants and also animals living in those areas and also nearby cities.
Okay, well, that's good to hear from Indonesia. What about other cities? I've heard good things from Tokyo, right?
Yeah, Tokyo has been like ahead of everyone else in the globe, actually. So they started to acknowledge the groundwater as the cause of the sinking since, I think, 1960s. And in 1970s, they imposed strict regulations on groundwater pumping. And now it has been slowed down for ages. And then again, the next question would be, how would they provide or supply the water for the people who need that? So they built dams and also reservoir in the nearby of the capital city, Tokyo. And also they purify those water, those surface water, and distribute it to homes and also industries. So they can provide or they can supply those clean water to the people. But also we can learn from other cities like Shanghai. Shanghai has injected surface water, the clean surface water that have been purified to the groundwater wells. So they basically replace groundwater that has been taken out years ago to the new one, the new clean from the surface water. And Shanghai has been successful on that. And also Los Angeles, I think, has also done similar, and some other cities.
That's good to hear. But you know, that's the government side of things, the initiatives that are being introduced. What about the people? We know there's a lot of people out there who are passionate to save their cities and do things for themselves, for their own cities as well.
So another alternative that has been proposed by scientists is building sponge cities. And this idea can be implemented not only by the government, but also by the communities. So imagine like sponge for the dishwashing. So, you know, like when you pour water in it, it will absorb, right?
Yeah.
And it will just go through the sponge to the base of the sponge. So that's the logic of using a sponge city concept in building like green and more sustainable city. So people have more like green areas in their houses, for example, or in public spaces in cities to absorb water from rain or from any surface so that it can naturally flow to the beneath the soil, to the ground. Then it will recharge the compacted land that has been like dried for ages because we take out all of the groundwater from decades ago.
Sponge City, I love that. Wow. I love the mention of the Sponge City there. What other solutions are people finding in other cities affected by rising sea levels? We have a clip for you. Let's hear it from Kunlé Adeyemi, an architect and founder of the African Water Cities Project, who's designed a floating school in Lagos.
Makoko floating system is really a prefabricated, easy to assemble and to disassemble floating structure built out of timber and sometimes bamboo, depending on the materials available locally. We've been able to build this in seven countries across three continents, improving on the technology and the systems every time, learning where it works, learning how it fails, and also improving in those areas. As the sea levels rise and the climate continues to change rapidly, especially around coastal cities like Lagos and many parts of Africa, we will continue to face the challenge of flooding and the challenges of urbanizing these waterfront developments. And I think building this way, looking at solutions that adapt to the conditions of water as part of the urban fabric will become increasingly important. And we believe these would be nature-based solutions that would allow us to thrive in conditions that would be otherwise very challenging. So in a way, these are sort of buildings that are not just for emergencies, but they can be part of smarter, more resilient futures for you know, many parts of the African continent and other parts of the world.
It's been so good to hear about the solutions, have a bit of a positive twist on something that can be quite scary as well with these sinking cities. Aghnia, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you for the invite.
What are your thoughts on all of this? Maybe you have some ideas on how to save sinking cities. Comment below, we read all of them. And don't forget to give this video a thumbs up to like and subscribe. You've been watching What in the World from the BBC World Service. I'm Ikra Farouk, and we'll see you next time. Bye.